Alright everybody, let's continue with our creation myth review. In this part two, we're going to look at some of the patterns of the creation myths, and then we'll continue in a third video with the remaining ones. Get larger for us here. Okay. So there are a lot of themes and motifs associated with creation myths, and I mentioned that we're just going to use Marta Weigel's nine-part system. And what we're looking at is that these patterns occur again and again throughout different myths in different places with a lot of similarities with cultures who have never even met each other. And some of these similarities are called archetypes. And I like this definition of an archetype, an original model after which other similar things are patterned. So Carl Jung was a psychologist who believed that archetypes were these symbols and patterns that all humans share, but that are exhibited differently in different cultures. For example, all humans share, for the most part, a fear of, for example, snakes or spiders or the dark. And these are archetypal patterns that may reflect differently around the world, but the underlying pattern is the same. So we see these in dreams, mythology, and fairy tales, Jung says, and that's what kind, when we're talking about patterns, we're really moving into the realm of archetypes here, and we'll come back to that term throughout the semester. So the first of Weigel's categories is called accretion, which means to build up, right? So layer A, layer B, layer C, they keep building up, and conjunction, the coming together of two different things. So, for example, let me go ahead one slide. In Norse mythology, we have a geography of Scandinavia, Iceland, that area, where there's fire and ice together. There's lots of ice, and there are volcanoes. When the two come together, rocks are moved around, and there are eruptions, and the earth changes form. And the Norse myth says that as ice and flames came together, the world was created. So what we find a lot in, and I have here at the end, in creation myths, is that the myths tend to most frequently, of all the different kinds of myths, creation myths do this more frequently, they tend to reflect the geography from which they come, right? So we know that, here's an image. Here's an image of, I believe, yeah, Iceland, volcanic activity in Iceland, and you can see the ice there, and you can see the fire, and that perfectly reflects the story here. Gnungagap is this abyss where the world comes to be when the fire meets the ice. So we see, for example, a creation myth in a world that's set on an island, right, like Japan and Polynesian islands and things like that, their creation myths often have to do with the ocean and fish, right? So these myths often reflect geographical concerns. All right. Secretion is when usually a god secretes something from his body that the world is created by. So these are not always things that are pleasant that we'd want to think of the world being created of. For example, we have a myth, Bumba, in our anthology that you had the option of reading, and he feels awful, he has a horrible tummy ache, and winds up throwing up the world. Okay? So anything that comes from the body, mostly these myths talk about the creation of humans or other deities, but we do also see it in creating geographical features as well. And here we have an image of Aphrodite, one of the Greek goddesses, goddess of love, right? And when Zeus cuts off his father's genitals and throws them into the ocean, the drops of blood that come from this mutilation result in the creation of Aphrodite, and she's born that way. Sacrifice myths are fairly obvious and fairly common, and some of these myths, remember we mentioned in the first video, they overlap, so there's elements of more than one kind, more than one pattern in a creation myth. But a sacrificed god is one who either willingly sacrifices himself, or more frequently sacrifices another deity, or a some other kind of creature is sacrificed, a monster perhaps in the Enuma Elish is sacrificed to create the world. So I have here the story of Pangu, one of the Chinese creation myths, and he keeps growing and growing and growing, bigger and bigger and bigger, and he eventually dies, and parts of his body become the different parts of the world. His skull becomes the top of the sky, and his hair becomes trees, and that's fairly common. We see a myth like this in Scandinavia. We see, again and again, we have these, the Enuma Elish I mentioned, that's a Babylonian myth, where the creature Marduk kills is made into the whole world. So these are sacrifice myths, where somebody is sacrificed willingly or unwillingly to become the physical materials for the making of the world. And here's an example of a statue made of Pangu breaking free of the cosmic egg that was floating on the cosmic sea. Right, eggs often feature, we'll see that in a moment. Division or conjugation. Division is taking things apart, and the cosmogonic egg is one of that. So you often have stories of this egg floating out in on the ocean, and eventually something causes it to break open and put into motion the creation of the world. So fairly common sort of creation myth. In the Finnish mythology, in fact, in a particular epic called the Kalevala, there is a virgin daughter of the air who becomes pregnant by the sea. How these things work are never explained, and that's sort of not the point. They're not science. They don't have to be explained. It's just the story, right? So she's pregnant for 700 years and just really miserable, and a bird, like a teal, a kind of duck, kind of a water bird, lays her eggs on one of the water daughter, and then she becomes water mother, she has several names, lays these eggs on her knee, and it becomes so hot, she doesn't want to move because she doesn't want to disturb the eggs, but the eggs become so hot that she finally fidgets and manages to break these eggs open, and the world becomes formed. The earth and the moon come from these broken eggs. So usually the material of the eggs or something inside the egg comes forth into the world and puts everything in motion to create it. And that is our conclusion of this first part.